2017 has been a surprisingly good year for high-speed rail in the United States. With the assistance of a growing base of nonpartisan, pro-trained grassroots activists, such as myself and the good folks over at the High-Speed Rail America Club, two significant privately funded high-speed rail projects in Florida and Texas have cast the car culture-loving NIMBYs who oppose them to the side, and are on track to begin operating in the actually foreseeable future. Here in California, similar successes have been had with our own high-speed rail project. Despite the best efforts of California's rail-hating Republican congressional delegation, who spitefully attempted to derail a piece of the project's federal funding by asking Secretary of Transportation Elaine Chao not to sign the final approval of over $600 million that had already been approved by Congress. But on May 22, 2017, after several months of frustrating hesitation, Ms. Chao at long last caved to the voices of reason who had for months clogged USDOT's phone and email systems, urging her to sign off on the funding as Congress had intended, and allowing the electrification of the high-speed rail's future route into San Francisco to proceed. While the city of Atherton, California, and their private attorney, California's NIMBY-in-chief, Mr. Stuart Flashman, will continue to waste Atherton taxpayer dollars with annual frivolous lawsuits, the courts of California will most likely continue to dismiss those redundant and baseless legal challenges, just as they did in 2016.
Constitution, California Constitution says when the voters approve a measure and you want to change it, you've got to go back to the voters. They didn't want to do that. And so they've taken the shortcut, it's illegal, and we are filing a lawsuit to challenge them.
The argument Stewart is still making, one that has already failed in court at least once, is that because the California High-Speed Rail will use the existing route of Caltrain between San Jose and 4th and King Street in San Francisco, it is somehow a violation of the language in Proposition 1A, the 2008 ballot initiative with which voters initially authorized the California High-Speed Rail project. Essentially, Stewart says that we can't use the money voters set aside to improve passenger rail service frequency and shorten journey times to improve passenger rail service frequency and shorten journey times, because the first trains to use that new infrastructure would be trains that already exist. You can probably see why Stewart and the city of Atherton were laughed out of court the first time, and you can bet they will be again. So at least, for the time being, all is well for California High-Speed Rail. Even better than you might have thought, in fact. It has been over 20 years since one could last take a train between Los Angeles and Las Vegas, Amtrak's Desert Wind train service between the two cities having been discontinued in 1997, a time when beating up on Amtrak in the federal budget was apparently a fashionable thing to do. But after many years of hard work and collaboration between state, county, and municipal governments, the tide is finally turning for passenger rail between LA and Vegas. And it's beginning to look like the once fully hypothetical Express West bullet train might actually happen, in spite of a number of early setbacks, including opposition to providing any federal support to Express West from House Speaker Paul Ryan and evilest elf on the shelf, former Senator Jeff Sessions, neither of whom ever seemed to be on the right side of anything. Before you rip into me too hard in the comments section for being a partisan hack, I should note that a number of the heroes in the still unfurling story of Express West are in fact Republican politicians, although with the exception of Republican Senator from Nevada, Dean Heller, none of those Republicans serve in either House of Congress. Along with former Democratic Senator Harry Reid, Senator Heller introduced legislation in 2016, which would have made it easier for Express West to acquire needed right-of-way along Interstate 15. Unfortunately, as is the fate of most bills, Senator Heller's bill died in committee. But let it not be forgotten that he did try. Fortunately, the death of Heller's right-of-way bill did not represent the death of Express West, and much to my own pleasant surprise, neither did the loss of Express West's former Chinese partner in the project, mainly due to issues surrounding the Buy America Act, a law requiring that rail cars be built in the United States if they are to receive any sort of government financing. Now, back in 2015, the people of Nevada had grown tired of the endless stops and starts of the various rail projects aiming to fill the void left by the loss of Amtrak's Desert Wind in 1997. Having missed several opportunities to obtain federal funding during the Obama administration due to the lack of government participation in these various rail projects, in the spring of 2015, the Nevada State Legislature passed Senate Bill 457 with a nearly unanimous vote. On May 27, 2015, Nevada's Republican Governor, Brian Sandoval, signed SB 457 into law, and the Nevada High Speed Rail Authority was born. Since its formation, the Nevada High Speed Rail Authority has been working in partnership with Express West to bring the dream into reality and continues to assist Express West as it hacks through the extensive red tape of United States railroad law and works to acquire all of the needed right-of-way along the I-15 corridor between the Vegas Strip and Victorville, California. West of Victorville, the route enters a more densely populated region of Southern California, where the density of development increases significantly compared to the sparsely populated lands along I-15. As a result of the increased density, the cost of building the line increases dramatically here, to the point that Express West would be unable to proceed on its own. Fortunately, the traffic-weary people of Southern California have been more than happy to foot the bill for this section. And this section of the future route is being developed by the High Desert Corridor Joint Powers Authority, a special purpose district established to develop the line between Palmdale in Los Angeles County and Victorville in San Bernardino County, most likely as a toll freeway with high-speed rail tracks in the median, as well as bicycle and pedestrian improvements along the way. Note that the two most powerful members on the High Desert Corridor Joint Powers Authority are Los Angeles County Supervisor Catherine Barger and San Bernardino County Supervisor Robert Lovingood, both Republicans. With the exception of Republicans in Congress, who aren't Dean Heller, friends of passenger rail transportation can be found in either major political party, albeit much more so at state and local levels, where governance is generally a bit less of a partisan circus. The section within Los Angeles County is already at least partially funded, thanks to the landslide approval of a transportation funding sales tax increase by LA County voters in November of 2016. It remains to be seen how the portion of the line between Victorville and the LA County line will be funded in San Bernardino County, but I'm sure that Supervisor Lovingood is cooking something up. The High Desert Corridor of Express West is especially important because it will enable one-seat service between Vegas and LA once the California high-speed rail has been completed, with future Express West trains expected to share the high-speed rail tracks between LA Union Station and Palmdale. While no dates have been formally announced for the initiation of Express West service, as of summer 2017, things are looking very promising, and the pretty horizon of passenger rail service between LA and Las Vegas appears nearer by the day.